Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon speaks with Dr. Anna Durbin, a vaccine expert at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. They discuss the logistics and ethics behind so-called challenge trials, a controversial method of testing a vaccine that would expose healthy volunteers to the pathogen to see if the vaccine works. Let's listen.
Anna Durbin, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, you're very welcome. It's my pleasure.
So today we're going to talk about something called a challenge trial, which can be done as part of testing vaccine candidates. And I'm wondering if you could explain to us what that means.
Sure. So what a challenge trial means is that we're actually giving the virus or the bacteria, the pathogen, to normal healthy people to see how they respond to it. And we do those challenge trials have been done for different diseases, mostly, as you said, in the context of vaccine trials. So we do those for vaccine trials for a couple of reasons. One might be, for instance, that there isn't a vaccine available for anyone, but the disease itself isn't occurring very frequently. And I think about Zika, for instance. Zika came very quickly. We were trying to get vaccine studies going, but it also then disappeared very quickly. So we couldn't do what we call an efficacy trial for a vaccine. And what that means is we need to see if the vaccine really protects against the disease that it's designed for. And the only way we can really do that, or I should say the best way we can do that, is in the natural setting where we give some people a vaccine and some people don't get the vaccine. They may get what we call a placebo, which is just something that won't, that doesn't have any active ingredients, or they may get a substitute vaccine that doesn't work against the disease. And then as the disease goes through the population, you see, do the people who get the vaccine, are they protected compared with the people who didn't get the vaccine? But to do that, you have to have the disease circulating in the population. If you don't have the disease circulating, then you can't test the efficacy of a vaccine. And challenge studies have been done in those circumstances to sort of recreate the disease circulation. And the advantage about that is a good challenge study or a good challenge model. And what we mean by model is we've given people the challenge strain and we see, do they get something that looks like the disease? And if they do enough people get that disease? Because the more people who get the disease in the challenge model, the fewer people overall you need in your study, because you're just comparing people who got a vaccine and were challenged compared with those who didn't get the vaccine and were challenged. So instead of doing, for instance, an efficacy study in 10 or 20,000 people, you can do an efficacy study in 1 to 200 people. So for that reason, people look at that as a quicker way, for instance, to bring a vaccine to licensure. But there's a lot of other complications with that that may not, that really aren't the best way, for instance, to look at a vaccine for what we call licensure, meaning to bring it into the public, to say it's safe and it works for everybody in the public. Because in our challenge strains, we use young, healthy people who don't have other complicating illnesses. And that's not the general population.
So I sign up for this study that hasn't happened yet, but so you give me either the vaccine or the placebo, and then you expose me to, in this case, to COVID.
Right.
Or a strain of COVID.
Correct.
And then you just find out if I get sick or not.
Correct.
So there's no cure
Correct.
For COVID.
Yes.
And people are dying, even young healthy people are dying. I mean, I also saw a story about a young woman who had to get a lung transplant. So then, what are the ethics of that?
Well, exactly. And I want to back up a little bit because I think a step that people aren't really familiar with or don't really think about is you have to develop your challenge model. So you have to find your strain of COVID and you have to give it to people and see what kind of disease they get. And you have to see if enough people get that, what we call endpoint, clinical endpoint. So I'm going to call it something like a flu-like illness. That would be the ideal. We certainly don't want people to get pneumonia or anything like that. But you have to do those studies first to see if your challenge strain would even work. And I think, again, you know, young healthy people have heard, oh, well, it's not so bad in young healthy people and they're not going to die. But I think the other issue is that they can have long-lasting complications. There have been young people who have had strokes. There have been young people, as you say, who have had a lung transplant. There's a lot that we don't know about this virus. And as you mentioned, there's no curative treatment or there's no treatment that I can give, for instance, to prevent somebody from going from a flu-like illness to pneumonia, pneumonitis, or death. And for that reason, I think it gets very complicated and you have to look at what are the benefits of doing a challenge versus those risks. So what ethically justifies doing a challenge? And proponents of the challenge model have said it will speed up vaccines. We can learn more about the immune response. We can, for instance, see if you've been infected once and you're challenged, will you be protected? Which are all good questions, but I think right now where we are today, where we have ongoing circulation of COVID-19, where we're learning every day about the natural history, I think it makes the push for using a challenge model really less important, or should I say less needy. I don't, you know, personally, I don't believe we need a challenge model today to look at vaccine efficacy. We have two vaccines that are just about to go into phase 3 clinical trial in the upcoming days and weeks. We'll have 4 phase 3 clinical trials for vaccine efficacy for COVID-19 by November of this year, just in the United States. There are also trials ongoing around the world. So I think it is very complicated, and the ethics of it are very complicated. And one of the really, I think, difficult issues around doing a challenge model now would be really ensuring that someone who volunteers for this understands those risks.
So you've done this for dengue.
Yes, I have.
And if you could briefly explain sort of why it was deemed to be the best way to go.
Sure. So there had been an efficacy trial for a vaccine called Dengvaxy, which is a live attenuated dengue vaccine. All of the indicators in the earlier trials looking at antibody, we all thought neutralizing antibody would show that the vaccine would work, would predict that the vaccine would work. And this vaccine made lots of antibody to the 4 different dengue strains. But in an early efficacy study, despite seeing those high levels of antibody, the vaccine did not protect. And we were at a loss then to say, how will we ever know which vaccine should we move forward with and which vaccine should we not move forward with? Because we can't rely on the antibody testing to tell us this is going to be a good vaccine. So we developed a dengue challenge model to help us evaluate vaccines early on before they went into large phase 3 clinical trials. And that was particularly important for dengue because subsequent trials of that vaccine, which is now licensed, showed that actually people who had never seen dengue before when they were vaccinated, years later, they were actually at risk for more severe dengue if they had gotten the vaccine as opposed to never have gotten the vaccine. So we really wanted to make sure that the candidate dengue vaccines we were developing and moving forward really were protective. And that's why we developed the dengue challenge model.
Mm-hmm. And so you were able to use a smaller number of people and able to find the candidate that wouldn't make people sick down the road.
That we think. What we found is that we knew that using this challenge model, we could protect 100% of people who were vaccinated and then challenged None of them got dengue. None of them, we couldn't recover the dengue virus from any one of them, whereas 100% of the people who were challenged had virus recovered for them. So that told us that this was indeed highly protective.
Mm-hmm. Terrific. So I also wanted to talk, you mentioned antibodies. I guess when we get sick, our body creates natural antibodies. In many cases, we won't ever get that same illness again. In some cases, we will get the illness again. I'm seeing some data that suggests that people's natural antibodies that they create to COVID are not necessarily long-lasting. And I guess the implications of that would be that they could get it again.
Correct.
So I guess my question is, if that's what's happening naturally, how will we create a vaccine that gives us a longer lasting antibody?
That's a great question. And I answer it first of all by just saying that we use antibody as a measure of immunity, but it's not all of the immunity that we have. And we know that the antibody titers can fall or the antibody levels can fall. But we're also relying on what we call our immune memory, meaning that when you're infected with something, you have a whole variety of sort of tools in your immune system that help fight that disease. And they sort of stand up when you're immediately infected and you have a lot of that immune response that comes out to fight the disease. But then those all quiet down when they're not needed. Because you don't want your immune system on high activity all the time, because that can be problematic. So it goes down, and your body isn't necessarily producing those antibodies all the time at high levels. So we do expect antibody levels to go down. What we're hoping, though, is that when you're re-exposed to different pathogens, your immune system says, hey, I remember that. I saw it before. Fight it, and it gears up not just antibody but those other parts of the immune system. So we don't know whether the waning immunity or the lowering of titers of antibody that we have seen in some cases of COVID-19, we don't know whether or not that means people will no longer be protected. What it may mean is that they won't get as sick. So they have lower levels of antibody, the virus will come in, but then your body will recognize it, gear up. So it'll prevent you, for instance, from getting pneumonia or severe COVID, but you still may have a flu-like illness. We don't know. We think antibody is the measurement that will best predict protection, but we don't know that. And we're certainly using antibody to look at how vaccines are working. But we're hoping that those vaccines will mimic your natural immunity or stimulate your natural immunity so that when you see COVID in the future, even if your antibody titers are a little bit lower, at the time the virus infects you, your body will recognize it, gear up, make more antibody, make other parts of the immune system work to clear the virus before you get sick. We don't know if that's the case, but we certainly hope that that's what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. And I know, for example, and from personal experience, I, for different reasons, twice have had my measles, mumps, rubella titers checked. And both times, over 10 years apart, both times I was found not to have them. Mm-hmm. And so I got booster shots both times. And now I've been told, you don't need any more boosters, you're immune. But it's not showing up in my blood.
Right.
But the expectation is that it will protect me.
Right. Yes, it will. And you're an interesting case because you're one of the few people who then doesn't mount a particularly high antibody titer to measles, mumps, rubella, and so that it's falling. As I said, we do hope, though, that if you were ever exposed to measles, mumps, rubella, your body would remember that. Just as it remembers when you get a vaccine again, you may have an immune response, but then the titer falls down again. It's really interesting. Some people don't mount good antibody responses and yet they're protected. And we think that that's probably, it can be for different reasons. It can be that your immune system is really good so that when you get vaccinated for those vaccines, which are live, so they're replicating viruses, your immune system is so good, it clears it before it can do anything. Or it could be that there is a take, we're just not able to measure it in you. And so when you're exposed, we would hope that you would be protected from those different viruses.
Mm-hmm. But I guess that complicates everything, right? I mean, because if you know, I'm likely immune to those illnesses. I will likely not get sick. Whereas you could do perhaps someone who doesn't have the COVID antibodies would get sick or wouldn't get sick. You just don't know.
Well, and that's a really good point too, because when we measure antibodies, there's different kinds of antibodies. That there's antibodies that recognize the virus but don't do anything to it. Then there's antibodies that recognize the virus and bind to it and sort of destroy it, kind of. But when we measure just quote antibody titers, we may or may not be measuring those specific types of antibodies because we have to do special tests to measure the antibodies that actually inactivate or neutralize the virus. And I just want to bring that back a little bit to challenge studies, because that's sort of a concern with challenge studies in that we do them in very young people, but we see the people who are getting really sick with COVID are elderly people, older than 65, people with other medical conditions. So even things that we learn from a challenge study in young healthy people may not necessarily translate to the older at-risk population. And that's something that we have to keep in mind as well. We know older people don't tend to respond to vaccines as well as younger people. So we may identify a vaccine or a dose of vaccine in a challenge study in younger people that may not actually relate to the at-risk population that we're seeing now.
So much to think about. Anna Durbin, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, you're welcome. It was my pleasure.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.